State Representative Janine Nodder and the host of Chatting with Janine. My guest this week, I have two ladies, two very special ladies. Town Councilor Barbara Healey, who's running for state representative, and next to her is Representative Mary Mayville, who is running for re-election. Welcome, ladies.
Thank you.
Thanks, Janine.
I like having all this estrogen in one room. Like, so, you know, voting day is coming up, November 8th, and it's going to be here before you know it. And I know we've been working hard trying to get our lit out there. I had mentioned on one of the shows, if you see a bag near your mailbox or on your doorknob, this is what it looks like. So you'll see one face, it says, and then in between are the rest of us. So we're doing our best to get it to you.
Lots of good information. So if you get one, you're lucky, please take a look at it. Learn more about us all.
Mm-hmm. And what our platforms are and what we plan to do with the rest of our 2 years.
Yes.
The next 2 years.
Yes. And hopefully we all get in because it is important. It matters who you send to Concord because we vote on things that affect people's wallets.
Absolutely.
People's Second Amendment rights and everything else. And there is a difference in policy. Mm-hmm. So you could be good citizens, be wonderful citizens and worthy of being commended for, going to all the different venues around town and events, but how you vote in Concord really, really matters. So now, Mary, you have a voting record.
I do.
That's good.
I spent my first 2 years as a freshman learning the ropes and, as they say, keeping my eyes open and my mouth as closed as I could, not too often, but a little bit. And I learned a lot, and I learned that it is really important to investigate and study and do the work. It takes time. And I think that bringing my experience as a professional, I'm a nurse. I'm actually studied and have a master's in nursing administration and a doctorate in nursing practice. And I've learned how to do research. I've learned how to study. I've been teaching nursing students for the past 20 years. So I think having that ability to investigate and dig into things makes a big difference when you're investigating and digging into things like politics and bills and such. So, and Janine, honestly, you've been a great mentor, as it has Maureen Mooney, in helping me to kind of shape my career as a new politician and really pay attention to the constituents in Merrimack and what they need and what they want.
All right, Dr. Mary, I know you have another profession. I also remember calling you Colonel Mary.
So, yes, I spent 24 years both active and reserve in the United States Air Force, and I actually just officially retired as a lieutenant colonel, again, as a nurse. So I went through, Barbara and I both are nurse veterans, and we went through some of the same issues together. But, I went through Desert Storm, Desert Shield. I was a reservist when 911 occurred, and I had a three-month-old baby at the time. I have, as Janine knows, I have five children, and my youngest was 3 months old when 9/11 hit. And I told my husband, get my bag ready. I'm coming home. Mm-hmm. You've got the kids. I'm going.
And so my youngest was 4 months old on 9/11 because we were pregnant at the same time. We were at the gym. We would, do our weightlifting class pregnant.
And honestly, I think that's part of what being, why we as nurses and as veterans, what we bring to the politics of New Hampshire, and that's that we're ready and we're willing. And that's a huge piece of it, not just, how you can talk, but we really do have the experience to do the right thing and to be the right person that I think Merrimack wants.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And I think it makes a difference too, because as an Army nurse, when I finally was discharged, I was a major. Again, like Mary, combination of active duty and reserves. And actually, I was just post-Vietnam, so my experience in the Army was a little bit different, but still, you are working for one of the largest corporations in the United States. So if you can survive in the military, you can survive almost anywhere. And that includes government as well. So
you've been meeting the voters around Merrimack. And what are their concerns? I'm sure the same ones. It's your turn.
The economy, inflation, gas prices, both fuel for the cars and fuel to heat their homes. Mm-hmm. It's scary out there.
It is very scary.
Exactly.
Even the grocery store, a bell pepper, over $2. I'm like,
yeah.
Well, I guess
and how
I'm not
fast the
that.
Prices have gone up. We all felt like COVID was awful, but we were stuck through it. We got through it together. and then we turned around and we're getting hit with this major inflation, which is, you really have to think ahead about what tomorrow is going to bring. And I'll tell you, it's scary. I think it's really scary. So.
Well, that's Biden's economy, because a lot of what we're seeing, it's from the federal government, which needs to be replaced. Oh, heaven help us.
And I belong to the VFW as well as the American Legion, and so I am actually with veterans quite a bit. And one of the major concerns they have, in addition to, if for those people that actually get their health care from the VA, they're not happy and they're not getting serviced the way that they need to get serviced. Mm-hmm. You know, I was talking to a gentleman yesterday, actually, at an event, and he was saying that just to get a hearing aid, it was a major project for him to get that hearing aid. And finally, he just happened to be lucky enough that he was able to go on the economy, i.e. go to a regular non-VA mm-hmm. provider, to get the hearing test that he needed to get the stipend from the VA to go ahead and buy his hearing aid. It took almost 10 months.
You would be good on the Veterans Affairs Committee in Concord.
Yeah, well.
I will recommend you for that. It's not the busiest committee,
no,
so
but that's
you could
okay.
do two. You could do double duty. Then.
But I think that's a good thing, because it's important to have people who have been in the military understand the concerns of the veterans, as well as they. It's even better if you're getting your health care from the VA. But I have a lot of friends, again, in the VA, the VFW, and the American Legion, that I can go to say, hey, what's this?
So, and just for clarity, VFW stands for Veterans of Foreign War.
Wars. Yeah. Correct. And versus the American Legion, which is stateside service.
And we respect the veterans. That
yes, we do.
We are the veterans. So I think having that respect and that honoring the service that our veterans have committed to the country, those both young and our seasoned veterans, that it's really important to have someone like Barbara and her husband involved with what they're doing. I think we all have our strengths. Speaking of committees, currently I'm on the Resources, Recreation, and Development Committee in the House, and it's an appointment.
That was Chris Christensen's committee, and he was our state rep for many years.
Yeah.
Shout out.
And it's fascinating, because a lot of it involves our resources. For example, you know, some of the issues with water that we have here in Merrimack, our wastewater, how that's handled, which is, we have a huge facility here in Merrimack, which many people might not know that's a revenue producer for Merrimack. And then our tourist industry, which is, our committee really looks at how tourism is brought to the state and how we encourage that. It's a multi-billion dollar industry, and it's really important to listen to the legislation that we have around how we run boats across Lake Winnipesaukee, and how we manage the rivers around the Rye District and the waterways around the our very small seacoast. But it's a really important committee when it comes to that. Tourism's a big deal. It brings money to our state.
Yeah. So, you know, I brought some photos along because the incumbents, you know, we all know each other, we're all friends, so we're running together, and you're married to one of the incumbents, so, you know, you've joined us, and of course, we recommend voting for the entire Republican ticket, but we do have some photos to show you. These are the incumbents, and plus Barbara and our senator. This is a new palm card that Melissa Blazek was very instrumental in getting printed for us, and we're hoping to get these to you as well. And on the back are just some bullet points. And we will show these again at the end of the show so you could look at it again, the tax cuts and the most fiscally responsible budget ever, empowering our students, and some bullet points on clean water. And we hang out at Los Primos quite often. You will see one of us at Los Primos. It's just our hangout.
And the Village Eatery.
And the Village Eatery.
Yeah, well, we try to go to all the restaurants and the places in town.
Tomahawk
Tavern.
Anywhere
there's a donut you can buy, and, you know, you'll find us there. But so shout out to all of them. And there we have our two nurses and veterans. And I forgot to say thank you for your service, ladies. And I mean that.
It's our privilege.
So there's Barbara wearing a lovely hat.
Not really. It's the gold dome.
Oh, you're right. There it is, the gold dome. And we are holding our signs on the steps of the State House. And there we are again. Oh, and I think, there we go. I love this picture. It shows us walking to work. So that's where we're hoping the people of Merrimack will send us to continue the work for New Hampshire and fight the federal government. Good Lord. Oh, you know, the Veterans Committee is also, the first part of that committee is state and federal relations and veterans affairs. So what that means is state to feds, buzz off.
Sounds good to me.
Yes.
We're trying.
Got to get you on that. So I see you both brought notes, and wow, I don't even have to ask questions. You just took off. I know you give speeches for a living, so good job.
Yeah, well, when you have 50 students in front of you and you have a 3-hour lecture, you know, several times a week, you get used to that kind of thing. So.
Well, we have 14 minutes.
Yeah, great. Okay.
And we come to a awkward pause now.
Oh, you know what I want to talk about? Like, here's one more thing. I'll tell you one more thing. This is really interesting, and people may not be aware of this in the state. I was appointed to the governor's oversight commission for the mental health workforce development, which is a big, long name for saying, how are we going to encourage mental health workers to come into the state, stay in the state, and take care of our folks who really need that assistance? And I just wanted to give a little shout out to our former police chief, Mark Doyle, because he was instrumental in helping us to get the 988 National Suicide Crisis Lifeline in play across the state. And the 988 number is very similar to 911. So you have that 3-digit number that you can call in a crisis, either a suicide crisis, a mental health crisis, or even a substance abuse crisis. So I just want to kind of give a little push for those of you that don't know. 988 is the number to call when you're in crisis, and we've got workers standing by to help you.
You know, I was at a conference in Denver, Colorado, and there was a booth set up. I think that's what it was now that I think of it. They have these little, you know, stress balls, but it was the shape of a police car. And I mentioned Mark Doyle, and they knew who he was. Hmm. So I brought home one of those little stress balls, and I went by his house and left it on the doorknob for him.
Yeah. Great.
I remember when our kids played basketball together. It was a long time ago.
Wow. I remember when his kids came to the door for Halloween one year. His oldest daughter was Harry Potter.
Is that right?
Yes. But then I have a good memory, and I've known Mary over 20 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's been a long time. Time goes by so fast.
It does.
Yeah, we've done quite a few things, and you know, and I'll because I'm you know currently active, you know, working in the state house. But you know, some of the things that we've done in Merrimack, just so you know a little bit about us, because some of you probably don't know much about us. And so I'm going to just do what I do and say, Barbara, you start.
You're on.
Okay. Well, you know, actually, I was born and raised in New Bedford, Massachusetts, which is a very blue-collar town. If you've never heard about us, we started off in the 1800s as the whaling capital of the world. And then now we've become one of the largest fishing ports in the United States. That and manufacturing. So, you know, nothing fancy about where I come from. I grew up in projects. So, but you know, I also went to college, and that's where I got my degree in nursing, and it was Southeastern Massachusetts University, which is now UMass Dartmouth. And I'll tell you, the funniest story happened during the primary. I had this guy walk up to me, and he says, "You graduated from SMU. Not many people know that." I was there, too. I was on the Student Senate. And I looked at him, and I said, "What's your name?" And he tells me his name, and I said, "You were the parliamentarian, weren't you?" Because I was the student senator for the class of 77, oops. And who knew some years later I would be a town councilor and running for state rep. So you never know where you're going to end up. But anyways, I've been living in Merrimack now for 13 years. And for the last 4, I've been a town councilor. And part of my duties as a town councilor is to actually sit on committees, just like these ladies do at the state level. So I sit on the planning board, which many of you know is exactly that. They plan how the town is going to develop and grow. My other is the Heritage Commission. So I have the future and the past.
Nice. So I've been a resident for 26 years. Raised our 5 children here, my husband Mike and I raised our 5 children here. You know, and I was quite the volunteer when I was a young nurse. I had a little extra time, I don't know how, but somehow I managed to do some volunteer things around town as well. So before we had public kindergarten, we had private kindergartens, and Merrimack PTA, where the Historical Society now sits, amazing building. I think it's haunted. I know it is.
I know a lot of kids that went to that preschool.
Yeah. So I was the chairman of the board for our parents and our teachers at Merrimack PTA Kindergarten when my children went there.
And Karen Shaw.
Well, shout out to those folks. And, you know, just engaged with our religious education here in town at Our Lady of Mercy. I was an MYA softball coach. That was super fun. and really involved in my kids' education. They danced all over it, Broadway bound. You know, they played sports. Another they're in high school
Jennifer
sports.
Jennifer DeFelice, yeah. Shout out again.
In the music program, you know, with Bunny Serenita, who yep. now is the high school. You know, I've just watched people grow throughout Merrimack, and it's just amazing to be part of a small town like ours. And I think sometimes we don't appreciate what we have here. And I think you have to kind of get out and explore a little bit and learn a little bit about more about Merrimack and its mm-hmm. folks. And we've all enjoyed getting to know each and every one of you that we've met on the streets when we're bringing our palm cards around and knocking on your doors, because you are just amazing people here. And Merrimack's a little jewel, and just don't tell anybody else about it, because we like our... I like our little town. So
yeah, it's growing bigger every day. I know we were talking to some reps from another district, and we asked that, you know, how many people do you represent in a small town? Said, oh boy, if we had that small of an area, we could knock on every door three times before the election day.
You know, kind of, I want to go into a little bit more serious topic, and that's kind of what we're looking at for the next legislative year, the upcoming year, and what bills we might think about moving forward. And, you know, I'm sure Barbara has some ideas too. One of the things I'm really concerned about is the parents' rights to the access of their children's medical records. I stumbled across this quite by accident when my niece, who lives in another state, called and said, you know, I was making appointments for my 11-year-old daughter. She needed some lab work done and an appointment. And on her 12th birthday, I called again and went online to make her next appointment. And suddenly I was getting a funny little pop-up that said, you actually are aged out. And the screenshot was, you're aged out of the medical record. And she didn't understand what that meant. And so upon further investigation, I found that there are many states that refuse to allow access, that block access of a parent and legal guardian to their child's online medical record at the age of, you're ready for this, 12 years old. Not 18 like we've always thought, you know, and we sign our lives away, but 12 years old. And I'm committed to make sure that it doesn't happen yet, to make sure it never happens in New Hampshire, to bar a parent, to actually force a child to make their own medical appointments, to go in and look at their own lab results and their own radiological reports at 12 years of age. And here we don't let kids really even rent a car until they're, what, 25?
Right. Yeah. Right.
12.
Yeah, I'm with you on that.
Good.
Wow. You know, and as a former critical care nurse, having worked in emergency rooms, you know, that becomes critical because we're talking about, you know, medical history, you know, do they have any drug allergies? You know, do they have, you know, epilepsy or some other condition? You know, what kind of medications are they on? And that's what a parent needs to know when they bring a child into the emergency room or to a doctor's office under urgent situations. They need to know that medical history so that that child is medically treated appropriately, not that you all of a sudden we have to go to a school or some other place to try to pull an electronic medical record. And then how do you get that if that child is unconscious? So it just leads to real issues with medical care, especially of an urgent emergent nature.
We wanted to discuss Don Boldick before the end of the show, even though he's not running for a state office, he's running for a federal office. And I know, Barbara, you've been involved in his campaign for 5 years now.
Yeah.
Well, the different campaign now, but the last 2 years, nonstop. And I don't think people know how much you and your husband, Bob, have been involved in his campaign. And we do attribute a lot of his success to the two of you.
Oh, well, thank you for that. I didn't quite realize that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we all talk about that. And Mary you. And I were in a press conference for Don, for the general.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, of course, the news really broke it down to just one line each. But
we're happy to be part of the Women's Coalition to support General Don Boldick. And as veteran nurses, we understand what it takes to be a leader when you're at the general officer level. And so that's why we're 110% behind him and supporting him in his run for the Senate.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yep. All right. We have about 5 minutes left. Would you like to do your stump speeches and then we'll go show those photos one more time?
So I'll go. Having been part of the House the past 2 years and really learning the ropes and figuring out how to move legislation through and watching it move through and understanding the process, which is quite complex. It's not as easy as it seems. And thinking about negotiating and collaborating. And I always said that, you know, I was a collaborator. I really do try to hear and listen to what other people have to say. I think I'm most concerned about the potential for future income tax. It never goes away. It does seem like an easy solution to solve some of the problems we have with our property tax, but there are many landmines and issues when you start thinking about taxing people. I don't think government's the solution. I don't think a large government is ever going to be the solution. I think the people are smart enough to know what they need and what they want, and they need to run their own lives. And I don't think government's ever going to be able to do that. So I'm all about the economy. I've been a fierce advocate for business owners, and I'm going to continue to be that. And even through COVID, when we had some conversations about, you know, our vaccination systems, I was the one that really said, look, a business has to run a business the way a business sees fit. And we as a government can't dictate that. And I'm going to stay committed to that. And I believe in that wholeheartedly. I also am concerned about education and really looking at how we each can obtain the best education for our children and our grandchildren. And so that's another piece that I'd like to continue to work on, is trying to figure out how you are going to assess and figure out what's best for your child. And I think our education system here in Merrimack is wonderful. I think our school, my kids all went through public education. At one time I had all five in five different schools, and that was, you know, a tough one. Too. But we did it, and they got great education. A couple of them went on to Northeastern, graduated and got degrees, and a couple of them went to community colleges, and they've all kind of been successful. So I think education is really critical and important, and we need to continue to expand those options for our kids.
Well done, Mary. Go ahead, Barbara.
Well, seeing how this is a different role for me from what I've had, you're probably wondering, well, what does she stand for? Because these guys you kind of know. So, of course, I'm for active duty and veterans for our military. I will always support our military. I will always support our first responders, whether that be the fire, the EMT, the paramedics, the police. They run into places where other people are running out of. And so the courage to do that just always amazes me. You know, I also support small businesses, because here, especially in Merrimack, it's our small businesses we have. We don't have the big box stores as a rule, unless you go down to 101A or you go over to Bedford. So it's all of our small businesses that keep us running every single day, whether it's you just need to pick up a little bit of this or that, or you're going out to dinner. I always try to support our small businesses first. And in fact, any new small business that comes to town, they can probably already tell you that, yeah, I was there usually on the first day to say hi, and what do you need, if anything? After that, this gets a little different, because I'm for common sense fiscal responsibility. I don't ever intend to vote for an income tax. I don't ever intend to vote for a sales tax. I don't think we need them. If anything, we need to look at what the budget is first. And just like we do here in town, we go through it line by line. And anything that's a program that's obsolete or isn't a necessity, we rule it out. But just like that, you also have to take into consideration what are the future needs and what needs to be fixed for routine maintenance. Because if you don't keep your buildings going and your operations moving ahead, just like the wastewater treatment facility, then you only get yourself in trouble down the road. So that's why I say common sense fiscal responsibility. Again, for those of you that know me, if I'm in the military, yeah, I've handled my weapons in my time. So yes, I am very staunchly supporting our Second Amendment rights. And, you know, again, common sense, how do you handle these things? And in fact, one of my favorite quotes come from the Marquis de Lafayette. I read, I study, I examine, I listen, I think, and out of all that, I try to form an idea into which I can put as much common sense as I can. I think that just about says it all for government. Thank you.
And we're both endorsed by several organizations, both mm-hmm. by Cornerstone. My record is endorsed by Cornerstone mm-hmm. and by the NRA. Well, yeah. I have an NRA
all
endorsement.
All three of us. Yeah, well, yeah. All of us. I think
yeah.
everybody.
Yeah, yeah. And the yep. New Hampshire yep. Firearms Federation.
And my husband,
coalition, rather.
My husband's a big Nashua Firearms guy. He's quite involved with that. He enjoys competition shooting, and he always was very proud to say, yeah, my wife's 5'10 and small arms qualified.
Yeah, 5'10. Well, I'm 5'2, and I got to shoot a machine gun, and you guys got a video of it. That was fun. I guess not the right word. It was empowering.
You know, we've had some, when we look at our voting records over the past couple of years, they also do, and this will be something that you'll see too, Barbara, that some of the different PACs will come in and say, look, we really appreciate what you did. And you know, I'll put them out on my ads, but was the Ebenezer Mudgett for
AFP, Marriage for Prosperity. Yeah. I have the Ebenezer Mudgett award as well.
Yeah, it's kind of nice to say, look, some people appreciate what it is that you do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, in the last minute, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for being on the show. Voting day is, I don't know what camera's on. I'm just going to talk into this one. November 8th, Tuesday, is voting day. We encourage you to vote the entire Republican ticket. And hopefully we will get these palm cards to you. This is the team there that I hang out with. But we encourage everyone to vote, again, the whole Republican ticket. Thank you for watching, and I'll be back with some more candidates all the way up until voting day.